Praise the Lord, everybody. Paz de Cristo, hermanos, and bienvenidos todo lo que está entrando. Praise the Lord, everybody, and just welcome everyone that's just entering into our study tonight. We feel very blessed to be able to have these studies again. Nosotros sentimos muy bendecidos porque nosotros podemos tener estos estudios. Estamos juntos con ustedes arriba de esto plataforma, just so we could be together, you know, just on this platform. And so we really, really appreciate the brothers that are just here with us tonight. And we're excited that Daniel is back in the game. Estamos muy contentos. Yo siento muy contento de estar aquí con estos, you know, varones muy fiel. Y también con nosotros tenemos Daniel. Él se siente mejor. Y gracias a Dios que él está con nosotros. Dios claramente está escuchando nuestras oraciones, ¿verdad? Porque está mejor. Nosotros estamos orando por él. It's just really exciting to have Daniel, and you know, I know his body is recovering, but I'm giving the Lord credit and our prayers for him. But at this time, I'm going to ask the men to just go ahead and say a greeting. Of course, we want to hear from Daniel as well, but you go ahead and take your turns.
I guess I'll start off. Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Paz y Cristo, hermanos. Gracias por sus oraciones. Thank you for your prayers. I'm just really grateful to be out of the hospital, first and foremost. It was not a fun time. I'm happy to be home recovering. I still got a small ways to go, as I was telling the brothers earlier. But by the grace of God, I'm here. I'm with y'all. And we get to hear word together, get to discuss God's word, and just be that iron sharpening iron, and just let God minister and pour out his wisdom and knowledge to us and through us. So again, thank you for your prayers, not just for myself, for my mom, my grandma, my uncle. There's a lot still going on with all of us in our recoveries, but by the grace of God, you know, he's going to shine through. This testimony is going to be powerful. So again, thank you all.
Great.
Amén, hermanos, paz de Cristo. Gustavo aquí saludándoles. Espero estén bien. Quería darle la bienvenida también. Estoy muy contento, muy agradecido por esta plataforma. Estoy agradecido de tener a nuestro hermano Daniel de regreso con nosotros. Es gusto mirarlo a todos ustedes. Espero Dios les bendiga. Si tienen algunas preguntas o comentarios, por favor, compartan con nosotros. Compartan, únanse a nosotros en esta noche, ya que la palabra de Dios es lo que nos mantiene adelante, fuertes, motivados. Y aquí estamos para servirles. Dios les bendiga.
Amén. Paz de Cristo, hermanos. Una vez más, estamos agradecidos aquí de poder estar por medio de esta plataforma, poder de nuevo impartir la palabra de Dios, la palabra que Dios ha puesto en el corazón del maestro y el corazón de cada uno de nosotros. Y just like my brother Gustavo just mentioned and Pastor mentioned, you know, we're super excited to have Daniel back, and we're really glad to see him and see that he's doing well. And I hope that everyone continues to comment, you know, during our discussion. And, you know, I was talking with the brothers and talking to the pastor over the weekend, you know, it's very encouraging to see the comments. And please feel free to comment. And you know, this is a discussion, and, you know, your opinion is, you know, it has, you know, it goes noted. So, you know, it's really great to hear from all of you. And esperamos, hermanos, que sigan comentando y sigan conectándose aquí a esta plataforma. Y nos da gusto de ver sus comentarios, y nos da gusto de escuchar sus opiniones y sus vistas en esta discusión. Y, amén. Vamos a seguir adelante, hermanos. Dios les bendiga.
Paz de Cristo, hermanos, praise the Lord, everybody. Once again, here we are. Most of all, grateful to see what God is doing. For all those that don't believe the COVID is real, you can ask Daniel. He's got a great testimony, and he's got an even greater testimonies coming. Para los que nos acompañan, gracias por acompañarnos, hermanos, paz de Cristo, y nos da mucho gusto que nuestro hermano Daniel está de regreso. Y para los que no han creído en esta esta enfermedad, el COVID. Ahí está nuestro hermano Daniel, es un testimonio grande y tiene más testimonios que vienen junto con el de él, pero más que nada reconociendo que Dios es grande y es soberano y Él nos va a ayudar en medio de todo esto. Les agradecemos su apoyo, sus oraciones, los que han estado orando por todos los hermanos, los que se han estado uniendo a nosotros. All of you that have been joining these teachings and that have been commenting on these studies, we are really grateful for you and que estamos muy agradecidos por sus comentarios y por su apoyo. Sigan orando por el ministerio, sigan orando por el pastor. You know, continue to pray for the minister, for the pastor. As we continue to pray for you, we are united, we are one church, and if we stick together, if we stay together as church, I know that's how Jesus left the church on earth, together, united, and I know that that's how he's going to pick it up. Yo sé que así como Cristo dejó a la iglesia unida y seguimos unidos, así dejó la iglesia unida al Señor, así de esa manera la va a recoger. Entonces, vamos a seguir apoyándonos los unos a los otros, hermanos. Siga compartiendo, siga comentando. Póngale ahí like and share, ¿verdad? Para que alguien más reciba también tal vez una respuesta por medio de este mensaje. Dios los bendiga.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for just your comments and just another great to have Daniel with us and everybody else. It's a gran cosa. Nosotros tenemos Daniel con nosotros. Y también todos ustedes que están aquí escuchando y gracias por su tienes hambre por en sed por las cosas de Dios. Jesús dice, ellos que tienes hambre comen, se llenan. So, you know, the Lord said, Amen. You know, I just really appreciate all of you that are hungry and are, you know, that come and listen to these discussions. I mean, Jesus said those that are hungry, you know, are going to get filled, you know, and Amen. so we pray that this is part of the filling, and at least it maybe even just open up or challenge your mind and your open up some things in your life. But before we start, we do want to keep, of course, Sister Serna, continue to pray for her, Sister Sandra. Also, Daniel, I know he's here, but he's not necessarily 100. He didn't say that, but I'm just assuming. And so that, you know, they could just be healed. Also for Brother Leonardo, he is sick. He is in the hospital. And so we just heard about that. So quiero orar por hermana Serna, hermana Sandra Escamilla, también por Daniel. Él está aquí, pero no es completamente sano. Y también por hermano Leonardo. Él está en el hospital. Está muy enfermo también. Oramos por él. So,
Sister Anita also asked that we keep Felicity in prayer.
Oh, yes, Felicity. Thank you. Yeah, she sent me a text. Yes, Anita, thank you for Felicity as well. So I'm going to ask Alberto, brother, why don't you just pray just for these folks? You could just, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Let's go before the Lord. Heavenly Father, we come before you, God, because we know we can trust you, Jesus, because we know that you are almighty and all-powerful God. And we lift up these brothers and sisters that need in this moment prayer for our brother Leonardo, Lord, for our sister Serena, for our brother Escamilla, for our sister Escamilla as well, and as well as for Felicity as well. And we just ask you that you just pour out your covering over them, Lord, and just declare healing in your name, Jesus. And we just ask you, Lord, that in tonight's word that you just speak to us, Jesus, and that you may use our teacher tonight, our brother Gustavo, Lord, that brings the word. Use him tonight. Speak through him, Lord, and that we all may gather something from tonight's word and tonight's discussion, Jesus. We just continue to pray for all those people that need the prayer in tonight and to all the people that are sick, Lord, I just ask you, Lord, that you just bring them back to healing, Lord, and bring them back to their normal state, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And I'm just one more. Gustavo's like a racehorse. Get it? He wants to start. just one more announcement. I'm sorry, my brother. I know the feeling. We are, Lord willing, we are planning the last Sunday of July, which I don't have the calendar in front of me. The last Sunday of July, we are aiming to have a service. We're still waiting for San Jose to give us the okay to open the church, but as of now, we can have outdoor services. So I spoke with the music team that was there on Sunday, and so we decided that we will have an outdoor service in our driveway. We could have up to 60 people. We measured it out. We could be safely distanced. We'll put tents up and all that, and we'll be able to screen everyone. And so we'll all fit in the driveway. And if Dios gets in, it overflows, well, that's fine too. So that'll be the last of, in Sunday of July, but we'll talk about it and confirm.
July 26th.
July 26th. En esto, el domingo, el último domingo de julio, es julio, domingo del 26, estamos planeando un culto. Ahorita las iglesias no están abiertas, estamos esperando la ciudad para dice la, si puedes abrir. Pero en estos momentos, la ciudad dice, nosotros puedes tener un culto afuera. So estamos planeando, estaba hablando con los músicos y hermano José Vargas, y estamos planeando de tener un servicio allí en nuestro pasillo, yeah, the driveway.
El estacionamiento de la iglesia, la cochera de la iglesia.
Yeah, allí sí puede estar los sillas, hay bastante espacio para estar, you know, todo puede estar bien con las leyes y todo puede estar bien, y también... So estamos planeando, pero si puedes hablar cuando los días pasan para más información por eso. Okay, so with that, we're going to turn this over to Gustavo. And as we continue in Titus chapter 2 and all the goodness that's in it and around it. All right, my brother.
Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. First of all, I'm grateful for this opportunity. Estoy muy contento por esta oportunidad. Y esto voy a dar un ejemplo. Hay un show que me gusta mirar en la televisión. There's a show that I love to watch on TV, and it's called Naked and Afraid. yes, for those of you that have seen it, the people are naked, but they blur their physical parts, so you don't see no physical parts. And the reason why I love that show is because, number one, I love nature, right? And I love seeing what people do to survive. It's a survival show. And this show, en este show, los manda a gente, escogen a ciertas personas, una pareja, un hombre y una mujer, y los mandan a ciertos partes del país, unos a África, otros los mandan al mar, otros los mandan a lugares donde llueve mucho y aún lugares donde salen según fantasmas, ¿verdad? Para ver que por un periodo de 21 días, a ver qué tanto sobreviven. So in this show, there's people that go on this show for 21 days and they leave them exposed to the elements. These people are naked and they're, you know, afraid, right? So they send them to different parts of the world, like Africa, and they drop them off in the middle of all just the African jungle. And other people go to different countries and whatnot to see if they're able to survive for these 21 days. And in this show, there's three types of people that I have been able to identify. The first type of people that we see are the people that are very afraid, that don't want to do nothing. They want to conserve energy, right? So these type of people, they just sit there. They, instead of building a nice home that would protect them from the elements or from the animals, they build some of them build a little bed made out of sticks. And someone barely build like a wall to protect them from the sun, and they don't care about everything else. They don't want to burn any type of energy. And so these are the people that, as time goes by, they become malnourished and they start getting scared and they start getting weak and they start getting sick. And eventually these people end up falling out of the race or the challenge. Y una clase de personas que hay en este show es un tipo de personas que las que quiero hablar es el tipo de personas que no quieren hacer nada porque no quieren gastar energía, quieren conservar sus fuerzas, su energía, y a causa de eso hacen unas casas muy débiles, no salen ni a buscar comida, they don't even go out to look for food, esperan ahí, no quieren moverse, nada más quieren dormir, tomar poquitita agua, hacer el menor movimiento, y cuando pasa el show, yo he notado que estas clases de personas empiezan a perder mucho peso muy rápidamente, y últimamente terminan enfermándose y son descalificados del show porque no pueden seguir adelante. La siguiente, the next type of people that I've been able to observe in this show is the type of people that they know everything and they want to do things their way no matter what. El siguiente tipo de personas que he mirado en este show son las clases de personas que según saben todo y quieren hacer todo a su manera. Y esta clase de personas dicen que tienen mucha experiencia y se sienten que son más grandes y más mejores que los demás y piensan solamente en lo que ellos quieren, lo que ellos necesitan. Y empiezan a causar muchos problemas, tantos problemas que ellos causan que su pareja mejor cuitee o que peleen y se la pasan peleando y se va uno y a última hora se da cuenta que sí necesitaba a su pareja y que debería haber tomado en cuenta, pero no. Y también se caen del concurso. This type of people that I'm talking about, these are the type of people that they think they know everything and they only want to do things their way. They are not team players and they end up causing problems between them and their partners and they cause their partner to not feel good enough or there's all, they just start all these problems and then their partner says, you know what, I'm done with it. It's not worth being here. This is not what I thought it was going to be. And they end up dropping out. Once their partner is gone, these people realize that, hey, I should have listened. I should have been a team player. They ruin their partner. Then they don't like being alone and they end up also not making it. But then you have these other type of people. These are the people that are always thinking about everybody else. Because this challenge sometimes is for 21 days and it goes up to 40 days. And sometimes they merge more than two people. And this one show that I saw, one of them says, I gotta go get food for my family. I gotta go get food for my family. I gotta go hunt. I gotta go get water. These are the people that are always thinking about the well-being of their partner. They want to make sure that their partner makes it through the end, all the way till the end. Y está el tercer tipo de persona que esta persona es una persona que siempre se anda preocupando por sus compañeros en esta carrera y hace todo lo que pueda, lo imposible para asegurarse que no solamente tengan una casa buena donde dormir y donde estar protegido de los animales, sino que también siempre se andan preocupando por asegurarse que hay comida y para todos, no solamente para ellos. Cuando agarran algo, por muy pequeño que sea, lo comparten con todos, porque quieren que todos estén muy bien nutridos y todos lleguen hasta el final. This is the mentality of this person. Well, such is Paul, Timothy, and Titus. They're this type of people. These are the type of people that didn't care for themselves. As a matter of fact, that they denied everything of who they were. They left everything behind for the Lord and for the love of the cause, for the love of the brethren. Y así como estaba mencionando esta tercera persona, hermanos, así es como es la clase de persona que era el apóstol Pablo, era Timoteo y era Tito. Esta clase de personas que negaron a sí mismos, se negaron a sí mismos, y se dedicaron al servicio de los demás, asegurarse que los demás, que la iglesia, que los hermanos siguiera adelante, que se alimentara y los protegieron y entregaron todo por ellos. The scripture the pastor gave us to, if Jose, you can put it up in Spanish, please. Titus 2, 11 through 15. Y vamos a leerlo. We're going to read it. Yo la tengo en inglés. Ustedes me siguen en español, por favor. Dice, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness, worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age. Verse 13, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearance of our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. Speak these things, exhort, rebuke with all authority, and let no one despise you. As I started saying, one of the things that I left out purposely is that when these people are dropped in these places, they're left vulnerable, exposed to everything, exposed to all the elements, and being in places that they've never been, doing things that perhaps they've never done, a lot of them. Una de las cosas que no dije anteriormente es que estas personas en este show que yo mencionaba anteriormente son gentes que están vulnerables, los dejan en lugares que nunca han conocido, donde hay bestias, donde hay bastantes cosas que los puedan atacar o lo que sea, pero su reacción en la situación que está en la situación que ellos se metieron voluntariamente es lo que va a decidir si llegan al final o no. Their reaction to whatever's going on around them is going to determine, or their actions, their behavior is going to determine whether or not they make it till the end, right? So, como leemos en la Biblia, Tito es mencionado varias veces en la Biblia como uno de los asistentes más confiados del apóstol Pablo, y fue la persona que Pablo escogió para hablarle a los hermanos en Crete. I don't know how you say Crete.
Los cretenses.
En cretenses, eso fue lo que fue la persona que Pablo escogió.
Gracias. A Creta, a los cretenses.
De Creta, a los de Creta. Y lo que pasaba que los hermanos en Creta no tenían un líder que les ayudara. Ellos a algún punto habían escuchado el evangelio y habían creído en él, pero había tantas cosas que estaba pasando a su alrededor que estaban en peligro de caer, de resbalarse del camino de Dios. Y es por eso que el apóstol Pablo manda a Tito, le escribe esta carta a Tito y le dice: Tito, encárgate, ayúdame con esto. So, lo que pasaba en Grecia, en Creta, que los hermanos, les faltaba un tipo de sana doctrina, y fue donde Tito cabe en esta foto. The people of Crete lacked sound doctrine, and this is where Titus comes in. There was an absence of sound doctrine. So, as we read the scripture, we can see how Paul purposely uses Titus to not only protect the brethren, but also teaches the brethren to reject, and we just read it in the last verse, verse 15, to rebuke, to reject false doctrine, and lead people to God using sound doctrine. Miramos como Pablo deliberadamente escoge a Tito y lo empuja a que vaya y que hable con los hermanos y les enseñe la doctrina, y les enseña que reprenda y que rechace otras doctrinas falsas, y los encamina el camino, Señor, usando una doctrina sana. So, what happened back then was pretty much what's happening now. The people, the folk from church, the people from Crete were vulnerable. And they were in danger of falling away from the faith that they were introduced to. And so this is for this reason Paul left Titus in charge. Right now, if you really think about the situation right now, we're all vulnerable. The world is vulnerable. There's a lot of things going on. People don't know. People are afraid of going to work. People are afraid of going to the stores. People are afraid of doing things. And you know what? Because of that reason, there's many people with false doctrines that are taking advantage of a moment such as this to go ahead and offer their a false sense of security, a false doctrine. There's a lot of that going on right now. I mean, look around you. Everyone's scared. But just like Titus and Timothy, así como si nos fijamos ahorita, hermanos, ahorita vivimos en un tiempo en el que el mundo está vulnerable, así como estaba vulnerable hace años atrás en el tiempo de Tito y en el tiempo de Timoteo, cuando Pablo les encargó de los hermanos. Viven en un tiempo donde si no se les enseña, si no se les da sana doctrina, la gente, como en el tiempo de antes, estaban en peligro de caerse de la fe en nuestro Señor Jesucristo, de la fe en el Evangelio, y creer cualquier cochinero que les diera a otra persona con una doctrina falsa. Y si nosotros nos fijamos, es exactamente lo que está pasando ahorita. Ahorita, y con todo lo que está pasando, ahorita es una perfecta oportunidad que muchos están tomando para ir y envenenar y sacar la gente de las iglesias, hacer que la gente deje de creer en Dios. Entonces, nosotros como iglesia necesitamos de decirnos, de ponernos, but we need to stand up and say, I will not give up my faith. I will stand up and I will protect my faith. I will protect my children. I will protect my spouse. I will protect my way of life. I will protect my city. I will protect my home. Y así como lo hizo Pablo, como lo hizo a Tito y Timoteo, nosotros, hermanos, debemos de sentir esa necesidad de ponernos de pie y decir, ¿sabes qué? Yo voy a proteger mi fe, voy a proteger mis hijos, voy a proteger mi familia, voy a proteger mi ciudad, voy a proteger mi pueblo, la gente que me rodea, voy a proteger mi estilo de vida. Yeah. Pastor Bruno, go ahead.
Anybody? No, I was just gonna agree with you. Where, I mean, exactly what you're saying is I mean, we mentioned it last time, and I think I say it all the time, but really the basis of false doctrine always is that Jesus isn't enough. And so there's always something more that needs to be added to it. If in this time, it wasn't necessarily the Judaizers or people who used to be, you know, they were Jews and then they were Christians and then they reverted back to Judaism, you know, wanting to pile stuff on with Timothy and Titus and the churches. But also there was others' ideas where it's, you know, that Jesus isn't enough or we're not enough. And I think it's important to say, because like you said, Gustavo, that, you know, it's, you know, the enemy, which I don't like to give a lot of credit to, the enemy is always going to make us as Christians feel that we are not saved. You're right. I mean, you talk to any Christian, we've all said it. Some of us feel it right now. I know I'm doing everything right. I know I'm trying to serve the Lord sincerely, humbly, all these things, but I don't know if I'm saved. That is the lie. And that is what the false teachings, or if I may, the false spirits, the false spirit or the spirit of deception, even today, is saying, to the point of is what's the point? If I'm not saved, I don't need God. And so you're right. I think those of us that truly believe in Jesus and we're serving the Lord as we can, yeah, we want to protect these things, but also communicate it, which you're probably going to say, Gustavo, because I know the gospel is a big thing for you. And so it's just, you know, it's I'm saying all that just to agree with you, bro.
Amen.
Anybody else?
One thing I really like being emphasized here in the scripture as well, and in your point, is the whole end of it where it says, "Let." In my version of the Lexham English Bible, it says, "Let no one disregard you." And what I love about that is it's so easy for, like Pastor Bruno was saying and emphasizing, that we feel like Jesus, like we in general, not like us specifically within our church, but people in general begin to, again, like he said, make Jesus not be enough, make the cross not be enough. And we disregard like the things God already did for us, the victory God won for us. And in that same sense, when this verse says, let no one disregard you, that means what he did, it was enough. Not only that, but you are more than enough. The fact is, like, where you're at in your life, who you are in your life right now, is more than enough for God to just do amazing, tremendous things with. But whether it be from our, you know, traditional hardcore bring-ups, or our own hang-ups of the sins that we've done, or the lies that Satan tries to sell us and says, again, we're not good enough, we disregard ourselves. And I love how this verse goes through all these things about, how the verse goes through, you know, as it says here, exhorting and reproving with all authority, meaning just rebuking all the things with all authority God has given us and all that. And that's the part that we forget, that when we get called into these positions, whether it's worshiping, whether it's ushering, whether it's whatever title or whatever position ministerially God has given us in whatever avenue to minister and be his vessel, we are given all of his authority. So with that, we have no reason to disregard ourselves, because he's coursing through us. He is reflecting and pouring out from us. So that's why we can exhort and reprove with all his authority. We can rebuke these things. We can deny these things, you know, and that's why, even though it's hard, we can start living these like selfless lives and non-sin focused, non-worldly focused lives. And that's what I love about this portion of scripture that we're diving into and these things we're talking about. Yes, Jesus is enough, Jessica.
Were you going to say something, Jose?
No, más quería añadir a lo que tú dijiste, Gustavo. Tú mencionaste la sana doctrina. Okay, para muchas personas, el ir a una iglesia donde no se les hable sobre su estilo de vida, para ellos esa es la doctrina que ellos les gusta. Cuando estamos obedeciendo, como lo acabamos de leer en la escritura, ¿verdad? Cuando estamos obedeciendo más bien las concupiscencias de la carne, lo que la carne nos pide, entonces no estamos siendo guiados por el Espíritu, porque el Espíritu Santo es el que nos guía. Pero cuando estamos obedeciendo a la carne y simplemente vamos nosotros y queremos aceptar la doctrina que no nos hace sufrir, la doctrina que no nos restringe o no nos evita, entonces simplemente estamos viviendo una falsa enseñanza, como lo dice la Escritura. Hay un versículo que quiero compartir. Se encuentra en 2 Timoteo 4:3. Y dice, porque vendrá tiempo cuando no sufrirán la sana doctrina. No sufrirán la sana doctrina. Porque la sana doctrina se sufre. La sana, you know, sound doctrine is going to, it has to be endured. You have to feel like you're going through it. Doctrine has to be, the suffering the doctrine means that you're gonna feel that you are doing what you're supposed to be doing when you're being led by the Spirit. But when you're being led by the flesh, basically, you know, doctrine is not going to be a suffering for you. You're just going to create every excuse that you can just to be able to make it through the day. Para poder lograrla y salir el día diciendo, esta es la doctrina que a mí me agrada. En libro de Lucas nos dice, si alguno quiere venir en pos de mí, okay, si alguno quiere venir en pos de mí, niéguese a sí mismo. Okay, if anyone would like to come before me, let him deny himself. Dice, niéguese a sí mismo. Y luego dice, tome su cruz diariamente. Ahí está el sufrimiento. Okay, take off his cross daily and follow me. And then follow me. Okay, entonces, ahí es donde nosotros podemos tener ese acercamiento con Dios. Pero se trata de que estemos nosotros sufriendo la doctrina, pero en este momento tú lo mencionaste, Gustavo, Daniel también lo mencionó, both of you, Gustavo and Daniel, mentioned it, that a lot of people, they don't want to suffer the doctrine right now. They want an easy church. I want to go to an easy church where the pastor is greeting everybody at the door. It's giving me a piece of chocolate and telling the usher to take me and sit me whenever I want to sit down. You know, yo quiero ir a una iglesia donde el pastor me reciba y me salude la mano en la entrada, me dé un chocolatito y le diga al ujier que vaya y me siente, donde yo me quiera sentar, donde nadie me critique, donde nadie me diga nada, y simplemente ya nos está sufriendo la doctrina. E incluso, ya por último, hay personas que simplemente antes de ir a una iglesia empiezan a crear muchas excusas. Pues yo no voy porque ahí luego me empiezan a hablar de esto, luego me empiezan a hablar de aquello. I don't go to this church because right away they begin to speak to me about this and speak to me about that. And I don't want to hear about it. And that's not the church for me. So how can you live the doctrine if you don't suffer it? ¿Cómo se puede vivir la doctrina si no se sufre?
Okay. Yo tengo un comentario que hacer con eso. I have a comment to say about that. First of all, both of the scriptures that you guys use, those are scriptures that I'm going to read next. Do you know why Paul charged Timothy and Titus to protect and defend the faith the way they did? I mean, I don't know what you guys think, but in my personal opinion, the reason why Paul talked to both Timothy, because, you know, I agree with Pastor. Last week you mentioned that, you know, Timothy, both 4th and 2nd, and Titus, they go together. They go hand in hand. And if you read those books, you're going to realize that the sin that what was happening in Timothy was also happening in the book of Titus. El pastor nos dijo la semana pasada que si nos fijamos en el Timoteo y en Tito, nos vamos a dar cuenta que las mismas cosas que estaban pasando en las primeras epístolas de Pablo a Timoteo siguen pasando en Tito. Pero ¿saben por qué Pablo le pidió a Timoteo y a Tito que defendieran la fe en la manera que le hicieron y la manera que ellos respondieron? ¿Saben cuál fue? The reason why, and if you can agree to disagree with me, the reason why they responded that way was because both Timothy and Titus and Paul knew that, or they defended the faith in such way, was because false doctrines cause apostasy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The biggest reason, false doctrines and false Christians, because there is such, and I'm not being a judge, but facts are facts. La razón por la que Pablo y Timoteo y Pablo defendieron y Tito defendieron la doctrina y la fe, la manera que lo hicieron, es porque falsas doctrinas causan apostasía. Y eso va con uno de los versículos que tú leíste. O sea, I'm going to read it in English. It's one of you. I think you read it in Spanish. Now, the Spirit in 1 Timothy 4, 1 through 5. And I'm also going to read 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 6. Remember these words. Paul charged Timothy and Titus to defend the faith because he knew that false teachings cause apostasy. 1 Timothy 4, 1 through 5 says, Now the Spirit expressly says that in the latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and now know the truth. For every creature of God is good, and nothing is to be refused and received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God. And there's something else that was going on back then, why, you know, it's talking about food. But let's go to 2 Timothy 3:16. But know this, that in the last days, perilous times will come. For men will become lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of God, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. And from such people turn away, for this sort are those who creep into the households and make captives of gullible women, loading them down with sins, led away by various lusts. When it says that they have the form of godliness, but deny the power thereof, what does the scripture mean? Who is it talking about? What is it talking about? Believing that people that believe in doctrines of demons and people that appear to be holy, people that, right, that appear to be godly. What kind of people is it talking about? And what kind of doctrine is it talking about?
Right. I mean, no, you're exactly right. It's talking about people who have this appearance of serving the Lord or being in God and deny the power thereof or not having the power of God. And we, well, that might be a wide brush, but we had been taught for so long that that meant, like, you know, worldly people or non-denominational churches or whatever, where in reality, it's those that talk the talk and maybe even dress the dress, so to speak, but they have no power in them, which literally makes them false, you know, false.
Go ahead.
You're the
pastor. And what I was going to say earlier, and going back to this, I'm sorry to interrupt you. Please, you want to keep going?
No, no, that's the way it is. I like it.
What I was going to say is that in what we read, the doctrines that we have is somewhat, or is mostly explained in verse 14 of Titus. Let me see, 12, which says, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the presence of God. Mm. This is what Paul was teaching Timothy and Titus, that these are the things that they should live by. These are the things that they should do. Now, whatever we do with our doctrines now, remember, the gospel is what saves, not our doctrine. Hay que recordar, hermanos, que lo que nos salva en este día, en este momento, es el evangelio, no es nuestra doctrina. Y les voy a decir una cosa y después me regañan si quieren, pero mucha gente no conoce el evangelio afuera de nuestra doctrina que predicamos en la iglesia. Many people do not know the gospel outside of a doctrine. We don't. And we use it, and if we're not careful, if our doctrine is not in line with the gospel, I said it before and I'll say it again, the people that we win for the Lord with the gospel, those same people, we're going to chase them out with our doctrines. Si no tenemos cuidado, hermanos, la gente que nosotros alcancemos para el Señor con el evangelio, si nuestra doctrina no está ni alineada con el evangelio, y mirar como Pablo y como a Timoteo y como Tito, la clase de mensaje que Pablo le enseñó a los hermanos, si nuestra doctrina no está en línea con el evangelio, la gente que nosotros ganemos para el Señor Jesucristo, esa misma gente las vamos a echar para afuera con nuestras doctrinas. Y nosotros vamos a parecer que tenemos esa forma de santidad o de piedad, ¿cómo se dice? Piety. De piedad. Vamos a parecer que somos santos, bien vestiditos, bien peinaditos, bien perfumados. Pero vamos a andar echando para afuera a la gente. Es cierto, la verdad. It's the truth. It's the truth. You know that the biggest stumbling block for new believers, for people in the world, think of something. Where can you find something in the Bible that is the biggest stumbling block? And we just read about it right now. It's false Christians. Las una piedra de tropiezo más grande que nosotros encontramos en la Biblia para los nuevos cristianos, para la gente que tiene hambre del Señor, para la gente que está necesitada, para la gente vulnerable, no son los malosos allá afuera. Se vienen, se meten en las iglesias con nosotros, se sientan, se ponen la corbata, se ponen el traje, se ponen el velo, las faldas largas y hablan elocuentemente. Muchos de ellos cargan una Biblia. Es un cristianismo falso.
Yo pienso que la palabra que estás buscando es religioso.
Ok. Una persona, es cierto.
Yeah.
Una persona religiosa. Alguien tiene que ir allá.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. I mean, in a sense, it's not, I mean, and I know what you're saying, Gustavo, you're not saying, you know, it's not, there's nothing wrong with living a pious life, so to speak. Like, yeah, we want to live separate lives. No. We want to be free of sin. We want to be modest in our lives and all of that. It's when that turns into the brownie points of earning points with God. And then all of a sudden, you know, I'm holier than you. So then that means me, I have permission now to judge you or to condemn you because you're not living as high as I am. And then all of a sudden it becomes people's opinions, their own opinions on who's saved, who's not saved. And then they're treated in this way. And I don't know about you. I know I was victimized by that for a very long time, misjudged. People had me all figured out with never talking to me. And that's the false doctrine of that. I mean, you know, we're not in a sense promoting, let's just do whatever we want and we love Jesus. No, we know that God puts us, you know, we're in the covering of the Lord and we live a certain way in this covering. But it's when we begin to look at our own accomplishments and then judging others or derailing others, you know.
Sí, pastor, mire, el versículo 12 lo dice, porque la gracia de José lo subió en español. I'm translating as I'm reading right here. Dice en inglés, dice, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the presence of God. I'm all for people that have convictions and they feel they can and they cannot do certain things. But the minute that we start preaching our convictions to somebody else, then what are we teaching? Are we teaching the gospel or are we teaching what we think is right or what's wrong? You know, Pastor, which leads me to my next point. It is extremely vital, critical for us to read the Word of God and make sure that we remain fed. Si alguien está mirando y necesita, tiene alguna pregunta, yo le aseguro que si le mando una pregunta por mensaje texto, ya sea a Vargas o a Daniel, o a Alemán Alberto, al pastor o a un su servidor, nosotros nunca le vamos a rechazar. Vamos a hacer lo que podamos para darle una respuesta a algo que usted está buscando. Tomen ese tiempo, no dejen de leer la palabra de Dios, no dejen de hablar con hermanos, no dejen de buscar un tipo de tiempo en lo que ustedes se nutran de la palabra de Dios, porque el no leer la palabra de Dios nos obliga a creer todo lo que sale de alguna persona y tal vez esa persona nos está enseñando cosas extra bíblicas. Not reading obligates us to believe what we're told. And whatever we're told may not necessarily be even biblical. Right?
Extra bíblico. Extra bíblico.
O sea
que, por ejemplo, Gustavo, déjame, me brinco aquí un poquito. Detén tu caballo. Ok. Si mi abuela decide pagarme la colegiatura, y la paga por completo. En medio de mis clases, ¿tengo acaso yo que ir a dar un pago para la colegiatura? ¿Tengo que preocuparme por hacer mi colegiatura, para que mi colegiatura sea más barata? o pueda hacer algo para que mi colegiatura, vamos a decir, se cumpla mejor, o que yo pueda añadir al pago de la colegiatura de alguna manera. Is there any way that if my grandma decides to pay my college, pay me through college so I can go to college, and she decides to pay everything in full, is there something I need to do, like to pay more for it, or try to do something better so they can even bring the price down, or she already paid for it, right? Ella ya ha pagado por ello. Entonces, yo no lo puedo yo quitar ni poner a la colegiatura porque ya fue dada, ya fue pagada, todo fue pagado por completo. Entonces, el primer versículo que tú leíste dice, porque la gracia de Dios se ha manifestado para salvación. ¿A quién? A todos. La gracia de Dios se ha manifestado para salvación a todos los hombres. A todos los hombres. Estoy tomando un poquito de mi tópico de next week. Se ha dado para salvación a todos los hombres. Y lo que dice en el siguiente versículo, en el versículo 14, si lo pueden poner en inglés, versículo 13 me parece que es. Dice lo que tú le dices también, enseñándonos que renunciando a la impiedad. O sea que la gracia ya nos enseña que renunciando a la impiedad. La gracia es la que nos enseña. Entonces, la gracia nos es dada a todos los hombres. Grace is given to all men. And grace alone is what teaches to renounce to all of the worldly desires and to live at this time. Y vivir en este tiempo. No como dice Pancho, no como dice Pedro, ¿verdad? Pero como nos dice la palabra de Dios, así como tú lo estás diciendo, Gustavo, you know, just the way the Bible teaches, not as anybody else is trying to sweeten it out or make it worse. You have to pay a higher price. No, no, no. La gracia ya ha sido dada. Es una perla preciosa, es un regalo precioso. Que no se le puede añadir, no se le puede quitar. You cannot take away, you cannot add. Grace is grace, and it's enough, and it's sufficient. And grace alone is what's going to give us the wisdom to renounce the other things.
Amen.
Amen. I mean, amen. It's true. It's again religiosity, or the religious. It's always on our efforts, on our works. My works, what I am doing, I compare what I'm doing to what you're doing. And if I, you know, and if I'm doing more than you're doing, as I think, then I'm more religious than you. And that's the crux of the false teachers. That's mm-hmm. what it was. That's what it was with the Judaizers, where they says, no, you need to be circumcised. No, you need to eat kosher. No, you need to do all these things, where Paul and later Timothy and Titus are all saying, no, you don't need these religious practices, and you do them if you want to do them, but it has nothing to do with, as you said, Brother Vargas, the complete work of Jesus or living in the grace of God. And that's and I think it could go the other way too, because I know we're all very focused on, you know, our experiences in our church that were very dogmatic and a very standard based, but it could be the other extreme where, hey, nothing matters and let's smoke crack together and let's swap wives and the Lord loves us and all. It could be the complete opposite.
And still
say like, well, look, you're not doing this. You're not getting high with us. You're not, you know, you're not serving the Lord, you know? And so, you know, just great points that are being made, and you know, it's challenging for some of us, because we've been talking like this regularly, even for someone like myself, you know, I've been programmed in a certain way, and I try to undo the programming of feeling worthy and serving in the grace of God. So
amen.
Yeah,
if I may,
go ahead. Go ahead.
The talk is so good that it's like, if I don't speak up, it's like it'll forever hold your peace, right? But I just want to say, and I was reading last night in the first chapter of Timothy, First Timothy, And I just want to read this, and it says here, now the on 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5, now the purpose of the commandment is love from a pure heart, from a good conscience, and from sincere faith. And it says, from which some having strayed have turned aside to idle talk, right? So this right here is just pretty much self-explanatory here. So we're talking about how, you know, so this is the easy part, right? The easy part is to point out everybody's flaws. The easy part is to say you're living wrong and you should live this way. Or it's so easy to do that. That's not the point. You know, I think the point is that, you know, we gotta teach the gospel. You know, and teach, mainly start off with teaching God's love, you know, to the people, right? Because you start pointing out, you know, flaws, and you start pointing out, the way for our living, that's not what this is about. You know, it's the heart is changed through the gospel. You know, once a preacher said, you know, if when you hear the gospel, or if you read the gospel, and you're moved by it, or if you're made uncomfortable by it, then that's probably something where we got to do, like, hey, let's do a self check here, and let's see how we're living our life. But it shouldn't be upon us to point out, you know, the flaws in other people, you know, because we have flaws as well.
Yeah, I think it's just really challenging that, like when a soul comes to church or to the Lord, right? We're trying to win someone, we're trying to bring our coworker or something like that. Right away, you know, a person is entering something that they have, for many, have no idea, or it's so different. And so a lot of times we know that there is some assimilating, right? Meaning, like, someone comes in, they transition from maybe a life of partying or this or that or bitterness or something like that. There is this assimilating into this new community. But what has happened over the years is, even that's a huge leap for someone. Even if they come and they accept the Lord, they get the Holy Ghost at a crusade or something, that's a huge leap. But then what the churches have done, again, this is a wide brush, doesn't necessarily, you know, everyone, but what the churches has done is we create another barrier before they can get to Christ. So they make this huge leap. Just like I was told, look, Jesus is going to set you free. You're going to be free, free, free. And so, yeah, I come. The Lord did set me free. And then it's like, oh, by the way, you've got to do this, 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 and this before you're free. Wait, I thought I was free from, like, when I got the Holy Ghost. And so what the church does is it creates another barrier from Christ. So as we, as individuals, or as a church body, we want to make the transition to Christ. If we get them to Christ, we're not going to trip about them stopping to do sinful lives. I mean, how much faith do we have in God that God could heal, restore, or deliver? That's a lot of times we lose that. We think, no, the church has to, like, slap people in the place and wear this and do that and stop this. And I know you've been common marriage with this person for 10 years, move out of the apartment, da da da. Like what the heck? Like, if we bring them to Christ, Christ will do the work.
And if I may just add to that, Pastor, you know, in talking to one of my relatives, one of my cousins, and I think, you know, he's probably watching at this moment, you know, but, you know, he was I have invited him to the church, and he says, you know, you always invite me to your church, but, you know, I'm going to be sincere. You know why I haven't gone to your church? It's because the last time somebody invited me to the church, they said that if I don't deposit my tithes in the entrance of the church, that I'm not allowed to enter. And I was just like, ooh.
Wow.
And I just, yeah. That's not what church is about. That's not what coming to the Lord is about. It's not about that. It's about, you know, what do you have to bring to the Lord, you know, from your heart? You know, Lord seeks the heart. Doesn't seek the paycheck, doesn't seek the tithe.
This reminds me of a scripture. One of the scriptures that has always touched me and has always messed me up, for the lack of better words. And it is in Luke chapter 18, verses 10 to 14. Sorry to cut you out, brother. You, oh, I, no, I, no problem. My bad. You want to keep going? Did you?
Oh, it's fine, brother. It's fine. No, you're good.
Listen to what Luke says. If you want to put it in Spanish, we'll say, I'd appreciate it. It's a Pharisee of the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector, right? In verse 10, he says, two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank you that I am not like the other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector, and he points to the man on the side, I fast twice a week, I give tithes of all that I possess, and the tax collector standing far off would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast saying, God, be merciful unto me, a sinner. I tell you this man went down to his house justified rather than the other, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and everyone who humbles himself will be exalted. Such a contrast, such a contrast of religion versus somebody who truly, and you see in scripture who is a person that God favors. That's why Paul tells us, well, Paul writes to Timothy in 2 Timothy 2:15, right? And so be diligent to present yourself approved unto God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing what? The word of what? Truth.
Yeah, truth. Mm-hmm.
What does John say? For you shall know the truth, and the truth
shall set you free. Amen.
Man. And when at the end of our career, and I'm going to finish with this, and I don't know if it's open for you, man, I want to add something else. And when it's all over, and when we are at the end of our career, at the end of our walk with God, at the end of our walk here on earth, we can say the same words that Paul said. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. The faith that I asked Timothy, Titus, everyone to defend. The faith that he teaches us that we should defend today. La misma fe que Pablo le pidió a Tito y a Timoteo que defendieran en aquellos tiempos, es la misma fe que nos enseña que nosotros debemos de defender. Y así para que cuando estemos a punto de terminar nuestra carrera, cuando estemos a punto de terminar nuestra vida aquí en esta tierra, podamos decir las mismas palabras que Pablo dijo. Pablo dijo, he peleado la buena batalla. He terminado mi carrera. Y he guardado la fe. Estas palabras fueron de Pablo antes de que él fuera ejecutado. Estas deben de ser las mismas palabras que nosotros debemos de guardar. Estar firmes, puestos, siempre prestos para defender esta fe que en el Señor que hemos creído y rechazar toda doctrina falsa y derrumbarla, esos ataques demoníacos que vienen contra la iglesia, contra los hermanos, contra los bebés, contra la gente, que tratando de arrancar la semilla antes de que crezca. Nosotros que estamos aquí hablando debemos de enseñar, de proteger, de nutrir y animar a los hermanos que leamos la palabra de Dios.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. I mean, amen. I mean, just circling back to what's the topic of this month, and that is, you know, living the doctrine, you know, living the doctrine of God, of Christ. And this is what we're talking about. We're talking about living in this grace, living in his mercy, living in his power. And not under our own power, because when we live under his power, then what happens? Then things change, and we conform, and that for some that's a negative word. We begin to form into the Christ likeness, or like Christ, with his character, his personality, his characters, and his fruit, and all of that. The you know, the tema de esto mes es viviendo en las doctrinas de Cristo. En estas doctrinas no son necesariamente, las cosas que se está pensando todos estos años, esas cosas muy estrictas. Las cosas que está mirando en la Biblia es las doctrinas, son las gracias de Dios y su amor y viviendo en eso. En nosotros estamos viviendo en esos, en el poder de Cristo, then, claro, hay estos cambios en nuestra vida. We will change. We will conform to the goodness of God. And so appreciate the lesson. Looking forward to what's to come. But man, if you have any closing comments, please.
Real quick, I wanted to kind of touch back on the points Alberto and Pastor were making about just us creating more so, rather than being bridges of people to Christ, creating walls and barriers and stumbling blocks for them. It says it in Titus 2:11 and 12, the stuff that we're talking about, the subject of this month. Of course, we all know the goal is the verse 11, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all people. So in that, we're trying to get that gospel out. We're trying to get that truth out. And then the second verse is verse 12, training us in order that, just right there alone, a lot of times the struggle, as Pastor Bruno was pointing out, a lot of people struggle with releasing whatever it is that they are viced to or whatever they're bound to in this world. And the thing about training, as my version of the Bible says it, training isn't a one-day thing. Training isn't just like a one-hour session. It's a whole mentality shift. It's a whole entire process. It's a routine that you have to get down. It's a recalibration of the brain, in a sense. So that's the thing that I think we need to start hopefully emphasizing per se, it might be the wrong word, but I'm going to say emphasizing with people that God loves you, God cares about you, and he has everything laid out for you and can transform you and remove all your struggles. But it's a process. It doesn't mean, for some people, like, we know testimonies where people had to give up drugs or whatever their lifestyle was, cold turkey that instance, and God powerfully moved in them. But for others, it might be something that is just so embedded in them that God has to perform this very intricate surgery to remove it, and that's okay. We're not asking that you give up your whole entire known lifestyle existence this exact instant. We're just asking that you get on that journey for it. That's why, the verse continues on. Me being an English major when I was in school, in that verse, it has has commas right after. So it's training us in order that, comma, denying impiety and worldly desires, comma, we may live self-controlled and righteously and godly in this present time. So even removing just denying impiety and worldly desire, that's the implication of it. So the verse is just saying that it's training us in order that we may live self-controlled and righteously and godly in this present time. But again, we need to be trained to be that. We're not going to walk into the church, give our life to Christ, and boom, you're like a Pastor Bruno. Boom, you're like this person. Boom, you're like them. No, you got to work towards it. Just like all of our occupations, we don't step in and they give us, all of the credentials we need and all right, go have fun, make your money. No, they need to teach us. They need us to grow into it. And that's the same thing with that. When we as a church start adopting this mentality of, hey, God loves you. God cares about you. He wants to reconcile with you. Come to him. We're here to help you. Not just reconcile that relationship, but mend whatever brokenness and remove whatever struggles you are dealing with is the other part that we as a church need to start emphasizing and embedding within our ministries, where we're welcoming, yes, but we're also mending and rectifying.
Amen. Amen. Micaiah 6:8, Micah 6:8, dice, oh hombre, él te ha declarado lo que es bueno. ¿Y qué pide Jehová de ti? Solamente hacer justicia, y amar, misericordia, y humillarte ante tu Dios. Eso es lo que Dios pide de ti. Eso es lo que Dios, Dios nos ha declarado lo que es bueno. Él nos lo ha revelado por medio de su Santo Espíritu. God has declared to us what is good already. Through His Holy Spirit, we can feel it. Y no tenemos que estar nosotros tratando de convertir a la gente. I mean, we don't have to be the ones trying to convert the people. You know, una historia, se la voy a decir rápido. I'm going to tell you a quick story. Había un hombre que se preocupaba mucho por su amigo, era su mejor amigo, y él le gustaba tomar mucho. You know, his friend used to drink a lot and drink a lot and drink a lot. Y este hombre trató de cambiarlo siempre, y le decía una cosa y otra y otra. Y en una ocasión le puso un ejemplo. You know, this man tried to change his friend in different occasions, told him many different ways. And one time what he did is he got a couple of cups of water. I mean, one cup with water, and he filled up the other cup with alcohol. Llenó una taza con agua y la otra la rellenó con alcohol. Y lo que puso un gusano en la taza con alcohol y puso otro gusano en la taza con agua. You know, out of those two cups of water, one of them was filled with alcohol, the other one with water, and he put a worm and the alcohol in a worm and the cup of water. And he told his friend, I want you to look at it and I want you to pay attention to what's happening right now. Quiero que mires estos dos vasos y que pongas atención a lo que está pasando. I mean, estaba tratando de dar una ilustración a su amigo. He tried to give his friend an illustration because he wanted to change him. Él quería cambiar a su amigo. Entonces, le dice, ¿estás viendo lo que está sucediendo? You see what's going on? The worm that was in the cup of water was still moving. El gusano que estaba en la vaso con agua se movía y el que estaba en el alcohol se había dejado de mover. Obviamente, el mensaje era claro. You know, obviously, the message was clear. But remember, we cannot change anybody. God is the one that needs to get the revelation through the Holy Spirit for somebody to change. Entonces le preguntó, ¿entiendes lo que te está, el ejemplo que te estoy dando? Su amigo respondió, sí, dice, yo lo entiendo claramente. Lo puedo ver claramente. I can see it very clearly. Alcohol is going to kill all the worms in my body. El alcohol va a matar todos los gusanos en mi cuerpo. Entonces, en vez de darle de cambiarlo con un buen ejemplo, lo instigó a que siguiera tomando, porque dice, sigo tomando alcohol, esto va a matar los gusanos de mi cuerpo. Entonces, lo que debemos de hacer nosotros es dejar de decirle a la gente lo que tiene que hacer y predicarles el evangelio para que vengan y sea Cristo quien nos cambie. I mean, what we need to stop doing is telling the people what they need to stop doing. And allow the gospel of Jesus Christ to make the change of the people. Just the grace, just what Danny was saying. Just when they come to church, you just let them feel the love of God. Cuando entren a la iglesia, que sientan el amor de Cristo, que empiecen a escuchar la palabra, que digan, alguien le dijo algo al predicador, porque yo siento que me está hablando a mí. You know, for somebody to come into church and say, somebody must tell something to the preacher because I feel that he's talking to me, that he's referring to my life. And that's what we need to do. And that is a sound doctrine. Esa es una doctrina sana de la cual nosotros estamos hablando. La doctrina buena, la doctrina sana, sin contaminación, sin mancha.
Amen. I just quiero agregar aquí, podemos tomar el ejemplo de Pablo. Can we take Paul's example? In 1 Timothy, it says this, and this is very touching to me, but this is what it says. 1 Timothy chapter 1. Verse 12 to 14, and it says, I'm going to read in Spanish. It says, doy gracias al que me fortaleció, a Cristo Jesús, nuestro Señor, porque me tuvo por fiel, poniéndome en el ministerio, habiendo yo sido antes blasfemo, perseguidor e injurador, mas fui recibido a misericordia por lo que hice por ignorancia en incredulidad. Pero la gracia de nuestro Señor fue más abundante con la fe y el amor que es en Cristo Jesús. And I'm going to go ahead and read it in English here. And it says, and I thank Christ Jesus, our Lord, who has enabled me because he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. Although I was formerly a blasphemer and a prosecutor and an insolent man, but I obtained mercy because I did ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was exceedingly abundant with faith and love, which are in Christ Jesus. So I ask again, can we take Paul's example? ¿Podemos tomar el ejemplo de Pablo? You know, Paul is talking about how he was showed mercy. He was showed in abundant, you know, by Christ Jesus. You know, can we show mercy to those that don't know God, that are hungry for God? Can we show that mercy to them? I'll leave with that.
Woo! This is a good topic. if Elmer was here, he'd say that is good.
You sound just like Elmer.
I know, it's weird.
I've been practicing. great, just great topic. Great, great discussion. This is a buen topical. It just is. I like the truth of God. You know, I like it. I like the truth of God. I like when we as humans, we're, you know, we can't help but put our own feelings or opinions and that in it. I understand, but just really, really trying to be as true as possible to the word. That's what feeds our souls. That's what sets people free. You know, es la verdad de Dios. Claro, nosotros somos humanos. Cuando se está leyendo la Biblia, tenemos nuestras opiniones, nuestras vidas, que estamos con un filtro leyendo. Pero cuando nosotros estamos, you know, buscando la palabra de Dios y leyendo, y estamos aquí, you know, enseñando, su palabra como si está leyéndolo, es eso que da la libertad a la gente, eso que llena el espíritu, cuando this is cuando el espíritu comen, you know, it's just the spirit, our spirits eat and are refreshed. But with that, we're going to dismiss. We have gone over time, but I don't think it's a big deal, but we have gone over, so just, you know, stay tuned. Mismo tiempo la semana que viene, miércoles a 7:30, como mis preciosos hermanos siempre dice, tiene hay la libertad para, you know, leer su, escribir sus comentarios, sus opiniones, y también habla con sus amigos y familia. If usted piensa que eso puede ayudarlos, you know, invite your friends and stuff if you feel that this is going to help them. And of course, always feel free to make your comments. But we're going to close with a word of prayer at this time. And I ask Brother Jose Vargas, brother, why don't you close with a word of prayer? And we'll meet back 10 o'clock, 10:15 this Sunday on Facebook Live with our regular service. 10:15 en este domingo, como siempre, nuestro culto arriba de Facebook Vivo. Okay, brother, why don't you pray us on out?
Amén, hermanos. Vamos a darle gracias a Dios. Dios ha sido bueno. Yo sé que su gracia, su misericordia no nos deja. Por eso es que podemos terminar el día. I know that His grace and His mercy is always with us. That's where we can finish the day. And I'm also grateful that we can join together with this group of men of God and be able to share with you and be on one mind and one spirit. So de esta manera vamos a orar y vamos a mantener a todos nuestros hermanos, a los que hemos mencionado, vamos a mantenerlos en oración y pedirle a Dios que los siga tocando, que los siga bendiciendo, que siga sanando todos nuestros hermanos. I want to continue to pray for God to touch and bless and heal all of our brothers. And yes, we're looking forward for the service at the church, at the church driveway. En la cochera de la iglesia, ahí estamos esperando verlos. Lo que vamos a orar, hermanos, si gusta, puede inclinar su rostro y vamos a hacerlo todos con fe en el nombre de Jesús. Padre eterno, Señor Jesucristo, te damos gracias, Señor, una vez más. Gracias porque es tu palabra la que nos ha permitido venir con una mente, Padre, con un mensaje que aunque llegó de varias direcciones, Padre Santo, a nuestros corazones, todo venía de parte tuya y tú nos has hablado. Por eso yo te ruego que nos ayudes a ser sensitivos, Padre, a interpretar tu palabra, así como Pablo instruye a Tito y a Timoteo. que tu palabra sea presentada pura, sana, Señor, sin contaminación, así por la gracia que tú nos has dado a cada uno de nosotros, por medio de tu Santo Espíritu, Señor. Yo te ruego bendizcas a todos mis hermanos, mis hermanas, a los ancianos de la iglesia, Padre Santo, a los viejitos que extrañamos tanto, Señor, poder estar cerca de ellos y abrazarlos. Te rogamos, Señor, tú también los toques, los guardes, a nuestros hermanos que se encuentran enfermos y a todos aquellos que en esta noche se acercaron a escuchar tu palabra, a los cuales tú en este momento les estás hablando tal vez por primera vez, Maestro. Ayúdales, ábreles el entendimiento también, Señor Jesús, y a nosotros darnos las palabras apropiadas para poder llevar el mensaje que ellos necesitan escuchar. Bendíceles a nuestras familias. Gracias por la protección que nos has dado en nuestros hogares, porque si no fuera por ti, Señor, nosotros no pudiéramos llegar. Te damos gracias, Señor. Bendice a cada uno de mis hermanos. Guárdanos, Padre, y a ti sea toda la honra y la gloria por siempre, Señor, en el nombre de Jesús, y que tu presencia nos acompañe. Amén. Amén.
Amén.
God bless all you. Dios bendiga, hermanos. God bless
you. Amén. Dios bendiga, hermanos.
Dios los bendiga. Dios bendiga.
Tengamos un buen semana.
Good to see you, Danny. God bless you, my brother.
Ha ha ha.